Hey guys, welcome to the Real Time Web Series. You're listening in to Burst, GBAC TMD from New Zealand. We're back with another episode with legendary artist, illustrator, painter, and graffiti writer from Grey Lynn. He is Elliot Francis Stewart, aka Deos TMD RFC. Welcome.
Hi.
For all of you tuning in for the first time, the Real Time Web Series is an in-depth process video meets podcast. Each episode basically documents the creative process of graffiti writers from start to finish and is then combined with questions asked by our online audience. So let's kick straight into the episode because we've got a hell of a lot of questions to get through and some really good ones too. So starting off with the first set of questions, which is more about background and history, I'd like to know, how did you come to select the name Deos?
Just mum gave me the name. Yeah, I wanted a name that began with... I tagged other things, and then I liked the letters D and E, and I wanted a word, and mum knew that word, and I liked it. So that's what I did, yeah.
Over the course of your career, have you kind of written anything else? Or is it, have you just stuck to Deos the whole time?
I wrote other things, so and then mostly Deos, yeah. But I liked writing other names. I liked writing Pork. I thought that was a nice name. And I wrote Marvelous sometimes because there was lots of letters and it was fun to do. But nothing in particular.
And how long have you actually been writing for?
I don't really know. I do know, like around 97. I decided to maybe take it more seriously, and like I know that I did tags when I was a kid in Pakuranga and stuff, and I knew I was interested in tagging, but I didn't know really what was the point and why people did it. And then I guess I met my friend Vincent, and he was quite good. He knew how to go like tag from small to big, and I thought, well, that's really cool. And I took it up maybe 97, and I never took it very seriously for a little while, and then I took it kind of seriously.
That's awesome, man. And what I'd like to know is, what's the first piece of graffiti that you actually recall seeing?
I saw lots of tags, and I can't recall all of the graffiti I'd seen, but I actually know the first pieces of graffiti was that I'd seen the coloured in pieces with highlights on that really captured me, and it was a 1 and a KO on Terakau Drive, and I later found out who those people are. Well, one of them. What doesn't happen to me now that did happen to me then was those pieces were incredible. Later DT and DLT, I think, went and did some pieces in an alleyway, and they drew Michael Jordan and Stimpy, and I thought those were also incredible.
Awesome. And some of the questions that we've received for this particular episode are from people that know you firsthand. And one of the questions that they've asked is, what's the significance of attending Auckland Metropolitan College and the impact or the importance of the friendships that you've actually formed there?
I guess going to Metro meant that I didn't go to a school with a bell. And so you fall out of form and fall out of uniform, which is kind of good for being creative, I guess so, because there's no whistle and then go. And at school, there were a lot of writers that were there before me, and there were a lot of writers that were there during school. So Askew was there, and he influenced me a lot. Vincent was there, and Tone, and lots of other, like, people were really into graffiti. And I guess, there was a guy, Dalf, he was quite into, like, really, really into it, and some people skateboard tagging was skateboarding for me, I guess.
How would you describe what the graffiti scene was like in Auckland during the 90s or late 90s, early 2000s?
For me, it was really wonderful. And like I said, pieces that were quite simple were really amazing to me. And just the notion that there was a train line that stretched for miles, that was completely filled, there was abandoned lots and uncared for areas which were usable spaces, and even without paint, just walking around and seeing how, I don't know, fucking really loved it.
Who would you say were three key writers that kind of stood out from that era of late 90s, early 2000s? Three or four or whatever.
I don't know. I feel uncomfortable answering that because I'm an asshole and I don't feel like praising people that I know personally. But I think it's quite apparent who influenced what, and I think a lot of stuff's kind of overlooked. Like like DAF is just way too important to overlook, and I feel like there's something about a New Zealand style that's really distinctive, that was distinctly not handed down with permission at all, but people were just so influenced by that sort of thing that I don't know how to explain it. It was unique. I loved it. I loved that shit. And I guess that's more than three individuals. And like our own gang, you know, like TMD has been amazing, and the RTR guys were really, really, really good at painting, you know. And you couldn't really ignore that. But of course there's other people that not just like shining gems that doesn't make for what is exciting. Like people like Fame and like Famester and K's and all of these other motherfuckers that I didn't even really know. And just with these brilliant styles, you know. With it all together, it looked really nice. People were unique. No one painted the same as each other either.
How long were you actually tagging for before you actually started getting into pieces and doing characters? What was the kind of process for that?
I think in 97 I wanted to do pieces. There was some stuff up on Simon Street which just I wanted to try and do that, and like I couldn't because I used Jeff's Emporium cheap gas station paint. I couldn't figure out how people outlined because I had chisel tips, all of that weird stuff, you know. Both go hand in hand, and I didn't really know that I'd go use my paint on pieces and then tag with it on the way home. And I really wish I just used my paint for tagging for a little bit longer.
Well, one of our viewers are aware that you used to live in Pakeranga, a suburb from Auckland, and then from there you moved to an area or a suburb called Grey Lynn. What's the significance of Grey Lynn to actually your upbringing within the graffiti culture?
I came here because my dad lived here, and other reasons. My family moved here, and I loved being in Grey Lynn, and I didn't think I would. I made friends, and I don't know. And then I decided I'd rep Grey Lynn, yeah, which was stupid, I guess. It's a stranger place now than it was before, yeah.
Well, we were just talking about Grey Lynn. What's the significance of K Road then? Because I recall, you know, when during the early 2000s, you were quite heavily associated to K Road, from my understanding, and that kind of scene there of graffiti writers.
No, I'd say that's definitely the case. Like, this is where my friends are. I like it. I like K Road. I like people who are badly baked, you know, not exactly normal, and I feel comfortable in that sort of surrounding. And I like people who are creative. I like to hear poetry. I like it when someone can drink and smoke and talk freely at the same time as be free about all of the things, you know. When everything is too normal, it's not comfortable for me. And when I lived in Grey Lynn, people were just sit on the porches, and I don't know what better words to put it. That was where my friends was. That's where music was played. That's where people could get wild, and that's where I decided I wanted to be, and I liked it.
Could you tell me some of the crews that you're a part of?
Part of lots of crews, namely a part of RFC, TMD, TLC, and BCM. The gangs that I like to represent for. I think they're all, you know, a little bit different, but I love all of my gangs. Yeah.
What are the differences between all these different crews? That's what I'm really interested to know. Why are you part of four crews?
Because everybody's a different group of people. They're not the same. They don't hold the same ideals. And I hold all of these things dearly. Like, if you take a group of people, like TLC. There's a whole bunch of friendly people from Grayland Park, like skateboarding and having fun, playing songs. And that's what they do. They're all young. I'm very happy to be a part of that.
What does RFC stand for? Because I know that was, from my understanding, one of the first crews that you were a part of before TMD. Is that correct?
Yeah. It stands for lots of different things, like all other gangs. It doesn't really matter what those letters mean. Yeah, it's a cool gang. I love it. And I guess it's my original one. I have it tattooed on me for some reason. And it kind of started, and it was, you know, like me, Beano, Prompt, Sens, Slope, Zach, you know, a bunch of guys, you know, not just everyone's in the gang that does graffiti, you know. It's all sort of moved towards fishing and, you know, real estate.
That's a really impressive list of riders that's in that crew, I have to say, and lots of people that I looked up to as well, in terms of what they created within the graffiti world. What I'm interested to know as well is how has RFC changed? You know, I'm assuming that when you guys first came together, you guys were friends, but your guys' common interest was probably graffiti. And how has that changed over time?
Just an old group of guys, I guess. And yeah, I think everybody still does graffiti in their time. You know, like, I do some little bits of graffiti. I like to tag on park benches. But occasionally I'll go and do a throw-up or something like that, and I think Vino and Prompt and everybody is sort of the same. You don't really stop doing that sort of thing, I don't think. You learn to play the guitar, why do you stop playing the guitar? You know, just life happens. Then every now and again, you play the guitar.
Could you tell me the significance of TMD and you joining that crew?
TMD guys are really incredible to me. And at a time when I was younger, I took more fascination into what people were painting, and I would really walk quite long distances to see pieces that were new, just to look at them. I'd still do that if something interested me enough. When I was asked to be a part of something like that, yeah man, I really want to be able to paint with the dudes that are really good at painting and do the right thing, you know, like by my eyes. Yeah, it would pretty much like being an honour to be able to paint with these people, my friends, and I respect them as painters.
What was the story of you getting put down in TMD?
I'm not sure. Like, I know I painted with Askew a lot, and Elliot, like, done a lot for me to be able to know how to paint and to want to paint, you know, like, really fueled that, and I think he had faith in me. I'm quite sure he like must have suggested it to the fellows. I don't know, to be able to paint with these people. Yeah, and a massive feeling, and like it also makes it feel like halfway like there's a responsibility in a way, because if you're painting with people that you hold in a regard, you do not really want to. You don't want to let them down, I guess.
You know, once you join such an incredible crew, you want to try lift everybody up as well, as much as other people elevating you, and that's quite awesome. One of the last questions, which is more about your background and kind of history, is some of our watchers or listeners want to know is, what is your best and worst experience in graffiti?
It's a bad idea to graffiti. That's the worst. Nothing comes of it. And the best is loving something. To love something that's nice. Like moles. Like lichen.
And moving on to the next set of questions, which is more about your influences and inspiration with the actual work you create. First question is, who are your key influences in your graffiti?
I don't know. I'd have to say Askew is an influence. Without him, would have never have attempted to do anything. And I would have just stayed at home watching Dragon Ball Z. It is really, really energetic and totally moved by it. And then to see when you put an energy into something, it feels good. Like you get a result from actually doing something. And he won't stop doing things. And so that is a huge influence for me. Now I know not to be afraid of anything. If I approach something and I want to do it, I know I can. I'm not afraid. Without that, I have to include that as an influence. And then for all the other influences, it's just the city that I live in, you know, and the painters that I'm around. There's not just one or two people in my life. There's lots of them. Some people paint with such emotion that to not be influenced by that, I don't know. Lots of just your surroundings, the product of your environment. There's no people. Like, of course there is. All the people.
What I'd like to know is, who are some of your influences for more of your character-based work?
Like, I like reading comics. And so I like a lot of cartoonists. Lots and lots of them. And I like more autobiographical, weirdo cartoonists as well. And I like what they do, and that definitely influences my style. And I like, of course, you know, with having traveled, you meet lots of people, you meet a lot of artists, and stuff like Twister and, is it Barry McGee, and who does his name, is those Brazilian Ostumios. Without seeing those things, I don't think I would have thought in another direction. And I don't know what those guys do, but there's something where you can feel like I'm just copying this dude Seth's words, because I think this guy's a really great painter, Seth. And listening to him talk, and he's like, you can feel the intelligence behind it. And I think that's true. Like, it is just a cartoon, but these cartoons, they're not patronizing or anything like this. Like, a child can digest it as well as an adult, but it's still intoxicating and it's like addictive. You want to look at it. I like how a story like The Emperor's New Clothes, it's a child's story, but it says a lot. And you can, and I think that's kind of for adults, is, you know, like, these things are real. Yeah, I'm just trailing off. I don't even know if I'm making sense. But yeah, I'm influenced by those dudes and just cartoonists in general.
How much influence or impact did Marty Edmund have on your work?
Lots. He's another cartoonist. Like I said, these New Zealand cartoonists, they're really fucking good. Marty was one of them, but he went in one direction. Other dudes have gone in other directions. But for me, Martin Edmund was like, I could get to see him on K-Road. He was interested in tattoos and rock and roll and all of these sort of things. And it just swole me with massive excitement. And his drawings are like cute, but talking about dangerous things, his backgrounds, his illustration styles. Yeah. It was really exciting, and like in that time of the 90s, it's like what was happening with music and shit like that. And then the way he drew muscles and clothes, and there would be like a smiley face badge and millions of shit going on in one drawing. Yeah, that shit's knockout stuff. I love it.
Who are maybe two or three people that you'd recommend that they read?
Go to the library, find out what you like and read it. But I do think, try and read some things that you don't think that you will like. Try and pick up a book of a style that you don't appreciate. And if the story is good, you'll find yourself really enjoying the style. Read Tintin. Tintin's great. I don't know. Explore comics. Do it yourself.
Having come from art school, you know, and studied for most of my life, did you personally have any, you know, kind of like fine arts training? Or are you mostly self-taught?
I did a course, an animation course, after school. I did for 1 year. I drew a lot at that course, but I smoked weed and fucked around. And I'd say, I don't think that you can go to a course and learn how to use a spray can. I think there's only really one way to do that, and that's to do it.
Obviously not just in my eyes, but I'm sure in many other people's eyes in New Zealand and around the world, you're somewhat a role model. And a lot of people do idolize what you do, whether you want to admit that or not. But do you feel a sense of obligation or pressure or responsibility, knowing that quite a lot of younger people look up to you?
I don't think a lot of people, younger people, look up to me. The only pressure I feel is the pressure to pay my rent. And if I want to make good work, I think I'd have to pay my rent first.
How can writers and artists appropriate and take inspiration from other artists without biting?
I think you know inherently when you're taking from somebody, and I think you know when you are paying a homage to somebody or tilting your hat. You know, you don't learn how to speak without learning the language of other people. An alphabet's just the alphabet. I speak in his accent. You know, I can see how French people tag. I don't want to tag like them. I can see how other people tag, and I just tag the way I do. I know who has influenced me. It's, like I told you, it's lots of people. Do you know what I mean? But my hand is still going to do what my hand does. I didn't ask my hand to do anything. I think if you ask your hand to do something, ask my hand to draw like I'm somebody else, then you're just drawing like somebody else. That's a good thing too. If Big Elliot made friends with these German people when the German people came along to this country, I'd seen photos of their work beforehand, but then when I watch those guys paint, a lot of pennies dropped. You know what I mean? I don't paint like Dame, but I saw a technique. Steal it. It's your God-given right.
One thing that I'd like to know is, I mean, this is slightly shifting more to what your work is actually about. What kind of ideas or themes do you actually explore in a lot of your illustrations and your paintings?
I don't really know, to be honest. I kind of know after the fact. If I look at something I done a long time ago, I can think, oh my God, this is what was on my mind, you know? And in truth, I don't really know what I'm on about. Like, I just want to paint things. And like, I like architecture, I think it looks nice, I want to paint that. As I said, baby's face, I think it's funny, I want to paint that. I think I see the cat walk past or do something, and I think, oh, I wonder if I can capture that. And then I like drawing hair or clothes or something like that. I don't know, really. And I think, like, I don't think it's smoking weed or nothing. I think, like, if you sit down, cool your heart rate or make your heart rate faster, I don't know. Something will happen, and then you're going somewhere. I don't feel like a bolt of inspiration when I look at a Bic lighter or something like that. And I draw a lighter often. I think it must be in my hand a lot. Same with a pen. I draw them. I just draw shit.
You told me that your environment kind of influences you a little bit. Could you tell me what that environment actually looks like? Tell me a little bit about that environment.
Right. Well, sitting on my porch, look at the wood. Look at the paint, it's chipped off the wood. The sun's gonna go down. When the sun's going down, you can see yellow light reflecting off one thing. If that post is painted white, the sun's going down, that's like an orange light. And then it makes the other side of it look like it's a blue light. Then it makes that beveled edge come out looking like something else. You can see all of the wood grain. I look at that every day. I look at the silhouette of houses as the sun's falling down. I can see the tops of all of these houses. Now I look at soon-to-be just high-rises.
What actually motivates you to keep creating your art and pushing the boundaries?
I'm not motivated to. I just have to. That's my job, and it's also a nervous reaction. And if you're left alone, you probably do the drawing. Other people might play guitar. I wish I could play guitar to express myself. That way I could get rid of feelings. But painting's more personal. But I like drawing. And if I can be quiet, then I'll draw.
Why do you create art?
I think in one way that maybe I can't hear well, right? And I've got a big family. There's a lot of noise. So I'll draw. I don't read good. So I'll draw. It's only really one place that I feel like has ever been encouraged. Now I'm an adult, and I don't have any other skill or trade. All I can do is meld ink or paint into shapes and sell them to people.
So if it wasn't a job, and you didn't need to do all these drawings for money, would you still be drawing?
If you spend a long time making an intricate drawing, it feels really good to draw it. If you spend a long time doing thousands and thousands of tags to the point where you lose yourself, it feels good to hone in and to render something. It's a mixture of chaos and ballet.
What some of our people want to know is, what direction are you hoping to take your work in the next 5 years?
My big goal is making everybody leave me alone so I can make something decent. I don't want to be cumbered by trying to draw hamburgers and milkshakes or whatever the fuck that you have to do. I don't really want to do that. I don't want to compromise. I don't want to dance. I don't want people filming me. I don't want any of this shit. I want to be left alone in my room with a pound of tobacco, 5 pounds of fucking tobacco, 1 pound of weed, a lot of fucking tea, my music, and to be left alone. And then for a really long fucking time, to be able to actually create something and actually think about what I'm doing
before I do it.
To actually be able to do something good would be a really a good feeling.
Left alone so that you can work on a series of paintings to develop a new body of work, is that what you mean?
Yeah, in a way. Like, I don't want to dance for people anymore. I don't want to make things that people like. I won't live unless I make it for people to like. It's not like I want to make something that people don't like. I want to be able to sit down and really basically to figure out stories. There's a lot that goes into painting. There actually is. And if I can really be able to have the time to sharpen my fucking blade so that I can make the cuts where I want them to be, I'll let it pour, man.
The next series of questions is more about style and process. I'd like to know, how would you actually define your work aesthetically?
I'm of the mindset that, like, I'm Elliot, and like, I like drinking and smoking. I like cups of tea. I like listening to people. I like doing shit, go on bushwalks and shit like that. But I'm also a total mess. But then when it comes to my work, I really don't know who that is. I don't feel like I am my line work.
I describe your work as illustrative and obviously influenced from comics, and but it also touches in the world of graffiti. Where do you feel like your work sits better within, I guess, which kind of domain? Graffiti, or do you see yourself more as a comic book artist, or,
you know, like, I reckon those are just fucking words, and it's sort of like, what kind of music do you play? And I don't know. I'd like to think of myself as a cartoonist, like an amateur cartoonist. I'm an amateur cartoonist if I had to describe myself. But I fucking like graffiti, and I think I get something about graffiti. Everybody gets their own fucking point of view. Everyone's got their own relationship with whatever they think it is. Do you know what I mean?
Are you an amateur graffiti artist?
I'm not a professional graffiti artist. Like, I'm not jumping in the ring, you know? Like, I don't give a fuck. I don't care about it very much. Like, but I love it. I like seeing what other people are doing. Do you know what I mean? Like, I really like that. Yeah, I'm familiar with it. I'm at least familiar with it.
What would you say, since you first started painting in 1997, what would you say are some of the key stylistic changes in your work over the course of, you know, past nearly 20 years of painting?
I don't know. I think I've gone down different directions, and I can't see them until it's been a long time after that. But I think inherently I'm not very much of a different person than I was to begin with. That's all it is. Like, my landscape has changed.
So one of the questions that we've got is, how did you develop your skills and techniques in painting characters?
I just kept doing them, you know, and I still feel like they're too stiff if I try to draw like a comic book styled person's face, you know. What I really like doing now is just outlining. Like, I've met people that don't draw a lot that have just got such clean lines that I get jealous, because I know I'm mongrelly. You know, I see a clean line, ooh, like this. But then I just have to be myself, I mongrel it out.
So we know that you paint a combination of pieces and characters. What's your preference?
It's all on the day. I'm getting less and less, like, I'm less confident with doing letters these days. I don't know why. And it's just easy for me to draw a face if I felt like drawing a face.
In terms of painting your characters, I know that you do paint a whole bunch of different kind of subject matter. Is there any kind of key things that is your favourite things to paint?
Depending on the painting. I like drawing jeans, but I hate painting the jeans all the way until the very end, where you can highlight a seam. You could highlight the seam at the start of the painting if you felt like it. It depends on what you feel like doing. I like doing pencil sketches. With subject matter, I think that's also on the day the same as swimming. Like, things will enter your head, and you might want to get them out. And like, for me, I hang out with my friends, and like, I like smoking weed, so I might spend a little while looking at a man's shoes. And I like looking at groups of people, watching one person in a group who wants to speak a lot, and reading his body, especially when everybody else is speaking. Looking at somebody and knowing that they're hungry, and wondering how I can show the language of the creature that I'm portraying, you know? Like, you can tell a rich kid dressed in poor kid's clothing off the fucking bat, because you can tell he grew up with a heat pump. You can see his skin is clean. You can see he's well fed. He could never be disguised. You can see it. You can read it. And I feel like you don't actually have to write words down to get something across. You actually don't even have to write down body language to get things across. Your letters are going to expose you, yourself. So any of your weaknesses that you carry are going to be shown, whether you like it or not. Like, look how many knobs are in graffiti pieces. No one can see it. It's like this big knob fest. There's shit like that, you know? A lot of self-expression actually goes into this shit, whether you like it or not. And it's like nature. It's disgusting.
From what I'm getting from what you're saying is quite a lot of the work that you create is freestyle, or is how much of your work is then planned?
All of it. I've been painting for ages. I don't like it when people think I'm going to do this and they go and do it to something. It's not how I operate. I feel like I go to a place and I think, what is this fucking place? How am I going to use this place? What is it doing to me? What does it want done to it? You actually have a relationship with these things. You have to be like a fucking mushroom, do you know what I mean? You have to seek some of the things. Like, you don't get to draw on a nice bit of paper unless you go and get that nice bit of paper. Maybe you spend $8 on a nice piece of paper. You put that on your room, you're going to have the hardest time painting on your $8 piece of paper. You might be able to draw something really good on a piece of refill, but try and put that on the $8 paper. See, this is a fucked up game, do you know what I mean? You might have a plan in your head and go through all hell on earth to reach your destination, to be unleashing your plan, but due to circumstances, shit hits the fan. Maybe just fucking respond to your environment with the mediums that you have, I guess.
Likewise with selecting your colours, what's the process behind that? Once again, is that freestyled, or do you have some colour palettes in mind when you want to do your work, or do you just work with what you have, or what's the kind of process of selecting your colours?
It's all column A and column B, and like, truth be told, like I said before, I don't really know what the fuck's going on, and so I don't know what colours is. I try to fucking know. So like, yeah, I'll use what I got, and that's kind of preferable to me, because it's like cooking. It's like, let's just use what we've got in the house. And then you go to the supermarket, you could have a fucking meltdown on what you could really have, and then, you know, when you really get all of the things that you want, it turns out you want something else. So you go to the food court and you get a red curry, and then you see your friend's got noodles, and you become jealous of your friend's noodles. You should have got noodles the whole time, but, you know, live and learn. There's life to continue.
What mediums do you prefer using the most?
That's all on the day.
Yeah, I like using a brush now, but I'm still got a long way to go to be good at using a brush.
I notice when, like say you've been inking for weeks on end under a lamp, you go out and you paint and you think that you can change those gears so easily, and I guess I'm becoming older with paint after I've been doing another sport. Those are things that are like subtly different, but are actually massively different. I can be ankle tapped on a gear change nowadays. So it all depends on what you feel like doing.
Would your preference be inking over spray painting?
If I got to do what I wanted to do, I would be inking a lot and spray painting a lot. You know what I mean?
One question that we've got, it's from your good friend Nigel. He wants to know, I want to know, and I'm sure everybody else wants to know too, but in terms of like lighting and having an understanding of lighting and shadow, how did you come to understand, you know, the process of shading within your work?
By looking at other people's work,
And then, like I said, by looking at that post, but it's kind of like that. The sun's that way, moon's that way. Oh yeah. I think Nigel gets it. I've seen him. He gets it completely. That's all there is really to it. How does light work? I also don't know. You see those one post, two shadows? It doesn't look right if you pulled it out of your own imagination.
How do you draw your characters? Have you got an in-depth understanding of anatomy or none at all?
None at all, really. I know we've got arms and legs and, you know, necks and ears. And I kind of think, like, under the notion of, like, with photos, then you have a real human. I still don't. I just know what anybody else knows, and I try to learn it. Like, I'm painting a neck in my bedroom, and I have a neck, and I can look at my neck in the mirror lots of times. And when I paint the neck, it don't turn out right. I don't want it to look this, or I don't want it to look so muscular. At the same time as I want those muscles to be there. All up to you how you want to paint it.
If you don't understand anatomy, how did you manage to draw his arm and chest in such a masculine way?
Well, I read superhero comics and I wanted to draw like a muscly guy. You know, like on this video, I think there's going to be this bottle and an ear, you know, and like, I look at a bottle lots and I look at ears lots. That ear is wrong. What the ear looks like that? What bottle looks like? That bottle isn't even transparent, you know what I mean? And like what Nigel Noja says, is like you can see that, like I try to just draw that the ear reflects off the bottle, but it doesn't reflect right through the bottle. There's lots of things that is wrong with that drawing. You can't see all the way through the back of the bottle. You can't see the rim on the other side. But I like looking at that twist top thing. Like I've been a long time drinking, and I'm staring at that bottle and I want to draw both sides of where the thing twists. It's also not right if you're drinking beer. You can see it's not right. Trying to illustrate that point and trying to enjoy the way that I want to use Frazetta. It feels nice. Yeah.
One of the last questions for this particular section, and it's a little more personal, but do drugs and alcohol have any influence on your art?
They have an influence on my life. Drugs and alcohol has an influence on everybody's life if you live in New Zealand. And sometimes I will like try and glorify that and be like, oh, look at all these bottles or something like this, at the same time as try to show how actually disgusting it is. It's not a good thing for you, man. And so like I said, how this wood around the porch has affected me. I draw wood a lot, I draw this porch a lot, and I draw drinking a lot. It doesn't make exactly a very a happy picture, but I'm not trying to draw a happy picture. I'm not trying to make a complete lie, and I'm not trying to make a complete truth either, you know. It's just, fuck it, this is my surroundings. It's your surroundings too.
One thing that I really like about your work is I just really feel like a sense of honesty behind it, you know. I feel like it really does come from you. And these, in my mind, when I look at your work, they're kind of like visual memories, you know, and not just experiences or things that are around you, but it's quite ethnographic as well. It's very personal. It's basically documenting or presenting your own story. It's like an autobiography kind of thing, you know. You're writing a story about yourself, but you're doing it through pictures.
Yeah.
That's pretty much, I feel like, what you're doing, and that's why I feel the honesty behind the work. Great, awesome. And the last set of questions, which is really more about your opinion and advice. What do you like and dislike about graffiti?
I like graffiti. I really struggle with what I think. I'm not necessarily right, but I don't... I want to see people being themselves, do you know what I mean? And I don't know, I think the internet, maybe it's me getting older, but I feel like a part of graffiti is kind of dead or dying, and maybe it's people trying to be sponsored or professional or something like this. Maybe I'm responsible in a way, trying to live my life through my illustrations. It's not my intention. I don't think that you should try and be good, because I like it when somebody writes fuck the police and gas station paint on the army building. I fucking adore that, because that is more truthful, obviously. And like, that's not what I'm, if I went in, it'd be a fucking lie. It would be a sheep in wolf's clothing, you know. It's just bullshit. Like, if I paint like fuck you, then you can have the truth. If it says fuck you on a bus stop seat written by me when I have to go somewhere, that you won't be looking at a lie. That's bullshit too. No, you will be looking at a lie. I think that you can feel it. I think that we're more than just six senses, and I think there's something like maybe tribal about it. I like it. I don't know what to say. I don't know how to encourage anybody in the right direction, and there is no fucking right or wrong direction. I miss a time where things felt a little bit more edgy, and you can't replicate a time. That would be stupid to try and replicate a time, so you just have to live now. And I just wish people, like for me, when I talk about like the late 90s, basically when for me it was trashed, but not in a bad way, you know. Like, downtown looked a specific way, and I become out to be a specific type of person because of this sort of shit. It's not there anymore. It's weird. And then I look at graffiti now, and it sort of looks weird. It's like this Pokemon has evolved into something I don't really understand. It looks plastic, cheap, warehouse version of something that was months made out of fucking tin, you know. That's what it feels like. Maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think I'm wrong. But also, I don't think that it's dead. I see people painting that are really fucking awesome, that excite me, and I just think these things are changing shape, and so am I.
That's a really exciting response to lead into the next question, which is, what are your thoughts on the current New Zealand graffiti scene?
For myself personally, I find it really dull. Hey, I live in Greyland, I don't have a car, I can't go to your neighbourhood. Maybe something exciting is happening somewhere, and I don't know where. I prefer to see things for my own eyes. I don't want to have to look at photos or some bullshit, you know. That's not cool. I could photograph my work and put it on the internet every day if I gave a fuck, and that's kind of pointless. I think let people discover your work and actually involve yourself with something. Like, you can take a photo of the cat. Do you know my cat? You've seen a photo of my cat. Do you know my cat? If you fucking meet the cat, you know the cat. And I feel like, let it be. Fuck, I don't know. Each to their own. Personally, your question was, how do I feel about it? I'm old and I don't like things anymore. I don't like anything, so I don't like it.
I know that you're talking about just Greyland, you know, and that you don't have a car, so you don't get the opportunity to kind of get around. Does that, do you think that the scene is healthy, or it's dying, or... You said it's dull. Is it going in the right direction, maybe?
I don't know. To me, it's dull. I did this for a long time. In saying that, there's a lot of people doing stuff that I'm kind of into. And I like seeing that stuff. From where it is now, from where it was when I knew it, they're miles apart, and a piece of the culture of it is kind of gone, like a part of a... Not a tradition, but there's something that has infected this demon. As like, it's like a sick eel or something like that. It was cruising down the stream, just ripping shit up. But now it's got a yellow belly and is just slowly waddling through stagnant water. Maybe that's me. Maybe I'm the sick eel.
What are some of those key, you know, you said from when you first started to now, you said that they're miles apart, what your understanding of graffiti is and how it's changed. What are some of those key changes that have happened, do you think, over the past 5-10 years?
I think it's things becoming easier and stuff becoming more quality. It has something to do with it. Where a secret thing, well, not secret, but, you know, you had to learn things the hard way. Paint was of low quality. There's something really nice about that. I think learning how to use bad paint is just like something you should already know. You know, that's an older way of looking at it. And so as things have gotten better and better and better, as computers have gotten better and better, everything's gotten better and better and better. And so maybe it's jealousy I have, maybe, or maybe it's maybe part of the old way has died. Like when somebody used to build a house with a saw and a drill that you use your hand, there's something more beautiful about that, the way that it was structured, than when they use an electric drill and buy kit set stuff. No soul radiates off it.
And I mean, adding to that as well is, you're talking about the soul of things and being hard to get, or you know, you had to figure it out yourself kind of attitude. That also ties in slightly to a slightly different question, which is, do you think that the kind of unspoken graffiti rules that you grew up with when you first started, rules or culture, do you think that those same type of rules and culture should carry on for the next generation of writers?
I think that's going to happen regardless. I was hanging out with some cartoonists yesterday. They like make comic books. They're really skinny, like wimp dudes. They started talking about this other cartoonist and how this other cartoonist went and smacked this other cartoonist in the head. I loved it. And I got excited. Suddenly I wanted to read both of their comic books, you know, and see who smacked the other one in the head. And I don't know whose side I'm on until I've read those fucking comic books. And drama's just gonna happen in life, man. Life's cool when there's a drama involved in it. Like, there's traditions and shit that are there for a reason. Whether you want to ignore them or not, it's up to you. Like, fuck what everybody says. You don't have to do anything that anybody told you to do. Fucking, you're doing graffiti, dickhead. Why do you feel like you should do something?
So while we're still kind of on the topic of New Zealand and graffiti, obviously we've got a lot of international viewers or listeners kind of watching this episode. What are some key writers or significant writers or up and coming writers that the international writing scene should be aware of from New Zealand?
My friends. So I like shout out my gangs, but they won't never, you'll never, people overseas will never be able to find out about my gangs. I like that. How are they going to see a nice vino? How are they going to see a nice prompt? How will they explore Gasp's work? There's not enough of this internet for them. Like, suck eggs, losers. You don't get to see the shit that really fucking rocks under these black. On the, my island of mud in the middle of nowhere, and it's not my island at all. Yeah, there's some cool shit. If you look under rocks, you'll find lizards. Some of these lizards are good.
So check out his gang, if you can find them. One question which we... What are your thoughts on the comic and illustration culture in New Zealand?
That's another fucking one of those kind of things, like life's like a yo-yo. When I was a kid, there was a comic book scene. Not many people know about it. Like, there's cartoonists out there like Will Saunders, and Carl Wills, Ant Sang, Dylan Horrocks. All of these amazing... Ant Sang's amazing, yeah. And like, all of these guys, they make amazing comics. There's a comic scene. But then when it comes to the modern comic scene, because I'm not on the, I don't go and like research who these new people are, but I know there is. And I know there's like, fuck, if I had a memory right now, I'd be able to tell you some of the names of these guys. Like one dude did this one about a splitting dog. The dog gets cut in half. It's fucking amazing, man. And it's at the library, a shepherd and a splitting dog or something. And there's some really, really good cartoonists here. But that's sort of an underground thing, I think, that you'd have to be interested to know. And like, yeah, I really hope someone else is making comics.
Why do you feel like the New Zealand comic scene is underground?
Maybe it's like basketball, and like some people have a light shining on them, and maybe not every amateur has a light shining on them. But I feel like New Zealand has a story to tell, and some people have written about New Zealand in books. It's nice, you know. And New Zealand comics are really good. And it has to be underground because not everybody in the world reads comics. It's like graffiti, except for graffiti's in your fucking face, regardless of whether you want to accept it or not. Comics are there, but you have to find them if you want to accept them or not.
Awesome. And, I mean, this question's a little bit different, but how do you feel about your art being used as tattoos?
Moderately uncomfortable about it, but mostly because I think there's like a tattoo style, and then like people get different, like, you know, like a Sailor Jerry type of thing, or there's an Americana type of thing, or there's a Japanesey type of thing, or a fucking thisy type of thing, or a thatty type of thing, and like, you know, I do my type of thing, and then like to turn that into like
like if I drew on a body, maybe I feel more comfortable about that and have like some sort of collaboration about it. And often I'm asked, and I do some tattoo designs, and I don't always really want to, do you know what I mean? I'm not the type of, I don't like compromising. And if I'm allowed to do whatever I like and you're foolish enough to want to put it on your body, you fucking suck eggs.
Having an understanding for myself that you do quite a lot of art, do you consider yourself a full-time artist?
I want to think of it like more like a tradie. With regards to that last question, it's like with tattoos and stuff like that, it's a difficult thing for me. What was the last thing? I'm a full-time illustrator and a full-time painter, and I don't get money unless I do this, and then I can pay my rent, sort of deal. So yeah, that's full time.
So would you describe your situation as a full time artist / tradie quite different to a fine artist?
It's all just bullshit terms as far as I'm concerned. Basically I paint, I draw, you know what I mean? And with all of the other ways of wanting to look at it, I never really understood. So I guess I'm like on the lower scale of things just because of that. And I'm fine with that because I prefer art that speaks to a person rather than some pompous shite, do you know what I mean? Like I want it to be readable, you know?
We're getting close to the end, and one of the questions that we've received is having an awareness that graffiti and street art are becoming pretty predominant in our city. People have a greater awareness of it. Okay. Would you encourage younger artists to pursue a career in street art and graffiti?
I personally wouldn't like to, eh? Like, I feel like it's a passing phase, but I don't know.
I guess adding to that, it's almost like, is it a viable career option?
Oh, I don't think so. You're better off playing the scratchy tickets, you know? Like, but I think it's important. Like, I think culture is important. And I think speaking with your language is important, and your language is more than just what your tongue and your voice makes. Your language is the way you walk. Do you know what I mean? Like, you'll notice dudes from Wellington whack their heads when they walk around corners because they think their hat's going to blow off. That's their body speaking. And if you think that it's not going to come out of their hands or come out of their brains and the way that they think, do you know what I mean? Like, you actually are completely... And that's why you should paint, you know, and literally keep painting, and don't be so influenced by the constant barrage that, like, you know, like, of course you have to respond to it, you know, but like if you continue painting, you'll find your fucking voice. And then when you find your voice, you can speak your fucking language, you can do your own dance. And I think it's a really important part of our life is to explore our culture. It's like I guess that's where responsibility lies in it. Is it sort of like if we don't do these sort of things and we just become members of the Simpson family, do you know what I mean? Like we'd just become nothing, you know? Like I don't want to become that. I don't want the whistle to blow and I march. I feel like, I don't know, I want to be, I'm a fucking hippie, you know? At the end of the day, I feel like I'm like a mushroom or something. I'm also worried that I might have offended people or some shit, or, you know, spoke too much. Like, I worry about that.
While we're on this topic of graffiti and street art, what is your opinion on street art?
I like it. I think it's cool, you know? I mean, at the same time, as I can see that people have some irksome frustration between the differences between graffiti and street art. I think that's kind of funny and neither here nor there. You know, I think, like, whatever form it takes, great, you know? Yeah, I like it. I'd still kind of like to see more just straight up, like I'm old and I like watching shit. Maybe I'm perverse or something. But I'd like it if somebody smashed over a stop sign and put a road cone in a tree and smashed a window and stole a scooter and wrote fuck on the neighbor's house. I mean, I think that's fucking cool and I like seeing it, you know? And not just that, like I want, like that's really bad way of putting it. I like to see the way that people really respond and shit like that. I like it. I like it when some fucking loser's written that he's lonely in a sewer tunnel. I mean, that's something that's fucking beautiful. It's something there, you know?
Are you okay when people see you painting and they label you as a street artist?
Then they labelled me wrong. I don't like that. No. You know, like, that whole fucking banky thing is irksome. It is irksome. It really is, because it burns everything down to looking like a fucking like a what do you call it? You sell it as a you write a happy birthday on it. Like it looks like one of those, you know, like a card. And like, even though I like that shit, it's like those are just cartoons. They're just political cartoons. Everybody got excited because $1 million is involved in the whole thing, and then no one can differentiate one from the other, and it's become confusing even for the public. Like, you know, you're painting a mural and you're allowed to, and an old man will take off his hat and say Banksy, and you say thank you, and you're kind of confused, like confusing time. It's all right, I guess.
One thing that I'd like to know as well, I mean, obviously the world's quite different now, but have you had the opportunity to do much travelling?
Yeah, I have had a reasonable amount of time to do some travelling, but I could always do with some more travelling. In fact, I really should do some travelling really soon.
And where are some interesting places that you've actually been to?
I guess, like, anywhere outside of Auckland is interesting to me, man, you know, and just like any other fucking person, like everywhere's amazing, you know. You're going to Europe is a beautiful experience. I got to go to Europe and I'd like to go back, and I got to see America and I really would love to go back, you know. I only got to spend a fly shit of time, but then I live here in a small place and I have completely not entirely explored New Zealand at all, you know. I've gone to the South Island, I've been to Stewart Island. Why should I? Because I still haven't even explored each fucking part of Auckland City alone, do you know what I mean? But going travelling through Auckland is a pointless idea.
Are there any specific places that you'd like to go visit?
I want to go back to Australia, and I want to go and see more of Australia. I think I like birds and I like the forest. Australia's crazy, and like I want to see some of the Australian countryside. I think that would be really nice.
Three more questions and we're wrapped up.
All right.
What would be three pieces of advice that you would leave for younger writers?
Get a good tag and get good at it, and whatever you think is good is not necessarily being like technically really bizarre or fanged out with blowouts and ting tangs and whizzle wazzes, you know, like. But tag thinking is really important, I think so. And doing something that other people don't do would be cool. I mean, I don't know. I haven't got any advice other than be yourself as well. Do something fucked up.
You mean by fucked up? Because that younger crowd might not understand what you mean by that.
What can you do? Like, if I was painting and I was more courageous, you know, I'm just saying, be courageous. Don't be afraid in more aspects than one, you know, like, yeah, just don't be a pussy.
No, I like that. What, in a similar vein, what would be three pieces of advice that you would give for aspiring illustrators?
Just keep illustrating, that's the job. I don't know, because I need advice. It's endless. Limitless things. That's the one nice thing that we've got. It's the one nice thing is the magic's never going to disappear. I've worked as lots of different jobs in life, you know, like in a kitchen and stuff like that. With cooks, there's something special going on there. And like, you can learn how to cook, you can get the recipe to, but actually, it's like dancing. There's actually something there. And like a knack or a ghost. I don't know what it is. This is maybe for like conversations that aren't recorded when you start talking about this thing. Yeah, you just got to keep going. There's nothing else to it.
Awesome. And this question, this last question, is from a good friend, PS5. Oh, you know what this one is. He wants to know. He said, "Please explain your bitter resentment against humanity."
That's unfair. Johnny's a friend of mine, so he knows that I get upset with everything, and I think everybody does. I know that going every day on a motorway is fucking annoying for everybody. It's fucking annoying for everybody. Living is fucking annoying, and I don't have any resentment towards humanity. I love the humans, you know, and I hate them as well.
Okay, so to sum it up, would you like to make any shout-outs?
I'd like to make a shout out. Shout out to my TMD gang, my RFC gang, my BCM gang, and the TLCers. Like, hey everybody, thanks for listening. I'm sorry if I offended you, or I'm sorry if I didn't.
Thank you very much, Alice, for all your time. It's greatly appreciated. Thank you for schooling us, sharing your perspective, knowledge, and insight. You've really provided an incredible resource for all our viewers and watchers, I'm sure, in New Zealand and abroad overseas. Hopefully for everybody else that watched, it was insightful, inspiring, and educative, and hopefully you've learned something. So I'd like to make a little shout out to all the IG accounts, blogs, and websites for sharing our link and video, and shout outs to Two Rooks for your support. That's greatly appreciated. And if you'd like to see more videos like this, make sure you subscribe to my channel, watch some early episodes, check out some more New Zealand riders. Drop us a like, share, and comment below. Make sure you leave us some feedback or recommendations on how we can make the series better, because we want to constantly improve the episodes. So definitely leave in the comment section below as well who you'd like to see in future episodes, and stay tuned for your monthly viewing of the Real Time Web Series. Thanks.